Hello and welcome to the worship this week. My name's Reverend Mark and I welcome you here from inside St. Nicholas Church here in Dursingham. You are very welcome to join us in our worship, whether you live in Dursingham, Anmer, Inglethorpe, Schoenborn or beyond. It is wonderful that we can connect together and worship our God. This week in our worship, Judy will be reading the scripture passage, Dave will be unpacking and sharing a message, and today on Mothering Sunday, I'm very pleased that Sunny, Henry and Elsie will be leading us in a time of intercession, considering today is Mothering Sunday. And Mothering Sunday is a day of mixed emotions for many, a day of celebrating and giving thanks for mothers and others who love and care for many different people. But also it can be tinged with sadness in many different ways. So through the intercessions in particular, we've tried to reflect the many different emotions on this day. As ever, there'll be a mixture of hymns and songs to aid us in our worship. So shall we commit this time to the Lord and begin in prayer? Almighty God, we thank you for this day that you have made. We thank you for Mothering Sunday, an opportunity to give thanks for mothers and others, for those who love and care in a healthy and wholesome way. But we also pray for those when today may be a day of challenge and difficulty. We pray that you'll comfort those. And as we draw together in worship, help us to look to you. Help us to have our ears and our hearts open for your word for this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we begin with a hymn and a song to begin our worship. Let's sing.
Thank you. The God of all comfort. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us all in our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. For just as the sufferings of Christ flow over into our lives, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. If we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our comfort.
So hello and welcome to this week's message, which will be given by myself. For those who don't yet know me, my name is Reverend Dave and I am the curate at this church here, St Nicholas in Dursingham. So let's pray before we look further into this passage today. Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your word. Help us to treat it as the precious gift that it is to us today. We thank you for the words of 2 Corinthians, and as we unpack this together, may everything that is on your heart this morning, Lord, be shared clearly, and all that isn't be quickly forgotten. Amen. So earlier in this week, my daughter Abigail woke up and she was complaining that she felt sick. I did my best to care for her, as any father would. I wanted to help her get started for the day, and so I got her up, made her some Weetabix at her request, and all seemed to be well. But I then made the categorical error of giving egg to a little girl who had a tummy ache. You've guessed it, very quickly up came that egg. And I set to work cleaning down the chair and the floor and all of the mess that had been left behind. And there was a toddler running around, my other daughter, attempting to jump straight into that mess. It was all a little bit chaotic, to be honest, but eventually all was well. After a brief chat with my wife, Weiwei, she took over. And Abigail happily jumped into her arms while I jumped into work. Then an hour later, on returning, I was greeted with a much happier little girl. And she said to me, "Daddy, I'm feeling much better. Daddy, I'm feeling much better." So Abigail had spent some time in the comfort and the love of her mum. And that love and comfort had noticeably changed her. She knew where to find comfort, didn't she? And she was markedly different from receiving it. She knew that mummy was the real deal. Today is, of course, Mother's Day at the time of airing. A day when we remember the love and dedication shown by mothers across the world, both in form of related family and, of course, in the many other different forms of mothering, which is like a glue, really, that holds our society together. Now, today, I will personally be calling my own mum, but also a good friend and supporter of mine who has prayed for me over a number of years of active ministry. And it's been sort of like having a second adopted mum. It's wonderful. I remember in more difficult times, finding comfort in the words of scripture that she would send across to me when I was living and working in China. And our passage today also focuses very clearly on this idea of comfort. In the passage we've had read to us, it's mentioned 9 times in just 5 verses. Of course, this year that we've just had has been a rather difficult time for many of us indeed. And for some, it's been marked with a more tangible sense of loss and grief than it has done for others. But yet, we've all been through something, haven't we? One way or another. I wonder where then you have gone for a source of comfort when you have needed it. Where can we find it? Is it in a close friend or a family member's love? Of course, that may well be true. And of course, we will go to receive that in that way. But in our first verse in the passage we've read today, we're instructed to recognize that the very center and core of all compassion and comfort is found in one source alone. We read these words that it comes from the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort. The Father of compassion and the God of all comfort. So comfort is found firstly in the Lord. He is the source of all that is good and comforting. He created the idea of comfort, of course, and he embodies it fully, completely in his character. So much of this past year, I think, in conversations, we will recognize there has been a marked sense of pessimism and the difficulty we've been facing, sometimes even despair in some conversations. But we, as followers of Jesus Christ, we have a very precious gift of comfort in knowing the Lord. And that's something I dare say all of us from time to time may even take for granted. We have something to give, don't we? Now, I don't know how this message finds you today. Perhaps you're having a great day. Maybe it's full of happiness and joy in the Lord. Wonderful, if that's the case. But perhaps it's been quite a different day for you and will continue to be. Perhaps you are instead longing for that comfort that is promised and spoken of here in our passage. If that is the case, be encouraged, because God has promised to be that wellspring of love and comfort to everyone who calls on him. Just as Abigail in the illustration at the beginning jumped into her mum's embrace on a day of feeling pretty rotten, God loves to gather us up in his embrace as well when we most need it. And as we look now to the fast approaching Easter period, we are of course reminded of the magnificent act of love shown in the cross of Christ, that sacrifice that meant we could be forgiven and reconciled to God. It's an incredible act of solidarity, isn't it, and love. And this is undoubtedly supposed to be of the most highest comfort to us, because it proves beyond a doubt that God's comforting outreach is not just a far off and distant touch, as it may seem sometimes, but instead it is a comfort that says, I know how you feel, because I've been there, because I sent my only son and he died for you. God understands what it's like to go through a tough time, because he's been there, because he's entered into this world with us and experienced the difficulties that we too face in our lives. So it's to be a great comfort to know that we have a God like this, who's willing to endure so much for the sake of loving and caring for us. So God is the source of all our comfort, is our first point. Secondly, through our suffering, we can comfort one another. Through our suffering, we can comfort one another. Now, as Derek helpfully pointed out in one of his recent messages, he said that a word like sacrifice is not popular at all in our modern culture. It isn't received well. It's avoided, probably. I'd say perhaps this is even more so true with the word suffering. Perhaps more understandably so. Suffering is not a pleasant concept, is it? Well, we live in a culture that is somewhat known internationally. Take my word from this. I've spoken to different people across the world. We're somewhat known for being a rather private people, aren't we? Somewhat stiff upper-lipped in the face of adversity. When we suffer as Brits, it's not something we really like to talk about, is it? Suffering isn't mentioned. Instead, we say, chin up, put on a smile, and we'll power on through it. Only this past year has reminded us that that isn't always possible, is it? It's not always workable to approach suffering in that way. We need a better response. In 1873, a Belgian priest named Joseph Damien was sent to minister to lepers in the Hawaiian island of Molokai. But the people there shunned him. It didn't work very well out for him. No one responded to his ministry, and after 12 years, Father Damien decided to leave. As he made his way to the docks to board a ship, he wrung his hands in despair. And as he did so, he noticed some mysterious white spots and felt some numbness on his skin. He realized that he had, in fact, contracted leprosy. When he returned to the leper colony, words of his disease spread quickly. Hundreds gathered outside his hut where he had been living, and they understood his pain. But the biggest surprise was the following Sunday. As Father Damien arrived at the chapel, he found hundreds of worshippers there. It was incredible. And by the time the service began, there were many more, and there was just standing room only. Plenty had gathered that day to worship, and his ministry went on to become enormously successful. The reason? He was one of them. He understood and he empathized with them. There's something remarkably profound, isn't there, in the experience of shared suffering, and how it draws us together and how it creates the opportunity for us to comfort one another in a way that we can actually relate better to. It was for this very reason that St. Paul the Apostle himself, who wrote this letter that we're looking at today, he actually made it no secret about his sufferings, did he? He talked elsewhere about his going through shipwreck, persecution, hunger, loneliness, even to the point of despair. Why did he talk about those things? Surely it'd be better to just not even mention it. Well, as is written in verse 4 of the passage today, the reason he did that is that in order that we might share comfort to one another, in order that we might share comfort to one another. Now, the context of the passage today is speaking mostly towards Christian persecution, going through something difficult, suffering because we've chosen to follow God. Now, that's something that perhaps many of us won't have experienced in our lives, especially if we've lived our whole life in a relatively free country like this one. So then, are we to just ignore these words and think they don't relate to us? Well, no. Emphatically no, for two reasons. Firstly, we've been commanded to remember our brothers and sisters who are suffering throughout the world, especially those who are in prison. And we can do so by praying for them. There are many different resources we can use to know how people are experiencing suffering in their faith through groups like Open Doors. Thoroughly recommend that you receive their resources if you don't already. But secondly, perhaps more practically to us directly now, we can remember that God's compassion and comfort is not limited to just experiencing suffering as a result of practicing our faith. No, it's much bigger than that. I wonder if you know what the shortest passage of Scripture is. It's found in John 11, verse 35. And it reads just two words: Jesus wept. Jesus wept because he felt the loss of Lazarus, and he wept at the reality of such pain in a world that he knew God had intended for much better things. So God feels pain when we feel it, and he longs to give his comfort to us during it all. Of course, Christ went on to raise Lazarus from the dead. Just shows that intention of love and comfort that he has for us all. Now, I don't pretend to know exactly how you feel today. This message will go out to far too many different people in different contexts for me to possibly know. But I'm sure that wherever you are, you've faced certain challenges and trials in the past year. But I wonder, during it all, how much comfort you have drawn from the deep wells of God's compassion. And then, when you have done so, how much have you gone on to comfort others with that? Because our passage teaches us that just as suffering can be shared, so also should our comfort be shared with one another. So take a chance to think, just for a moment now, is there somebody in your life that God is calling you to comfort today? Who might the Lord be leading you to give comfort to after you've finished watching this service today, I wonder? And then we then come to the close of our passage for today. And in our closing words, Paul, the author of this passage, writing to the Corinthians, reminds the church that he's writing to there that he is firm in the hope he has for them, firm in his hope for them, it reads. So what does this mean for the Corinthians that he wrote to that church, and also importantly, arguably more importantly, for us today? What does it mean? Well, famous author Robert Stevenson, a name some of you will be familiar with, I'm sure, tells of a storm that was caught that caught a vessel off a rocky coast and threatened to drive it and its passengers to destruction. In the middle of this terror, one daring man, contrary to orders, went to the deck, made a dangerous passage to the pilot house, and saw the steerman. He was lashed fast at this point, and he was holding the wheel unwaveringly, and inch by inch was turning the ship out once more to sea. The pilot saw the watcher, and he smiled. Then the daring passenger went below and he gave out a note of cheer. I have seen the face of the pilot, and he smiled. All is well. In Matthew 14, verse 26, we read that when the disciples saw Jesus walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. But Jesus straightway spoke to them and said, "Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid." The good news today, no, the great news today, is that the captain of our ship is steering a course that can be trusted. In the midst of this stormy time that does now seem to be improving, has to be said, let us return below deck to see the smiling steerman and be of good cheer. Let us remember, God is the source of all comfort, and that as we experience this form of shared suffering together, that we can also share out that comfort. But finally, let us also remember that we can be firm in our hope today, because we know the captain of our ship is leading us steadily through the storm. Let's pray together to finish. Father, thank you for your words, for the gift of it, and for what it may have stirred up in our hearts today. Father, we do thank you for the gift of mothering in all of its various forms, and for the comfort that we may well have received. We pray, Father, for all the comfort that you have given to us in its various forms, that you will help us to be generous in giving that comfort out to others, knowing that you are the captain of the ship, that you are the source of all comfort, and that you lead us on. Ever on. Amen.
Together we will now offer to God our prayers for the needs of the world, the church and ourselves. We pray for the communities of Christians gathered throughout the world today, for church leaders and for those of us who seek to follow Jesus in their life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Together we pray for all women, especially mothers and for stepmothers, grandmothers and aunties and all women who have loved and laughed, wept and worked to care for others. Bless all parents and carers and strengthen those families living under stress, especially during lockdown. For some, Mothering Sunday it is not a celebration but a time of sadness. May they have the comfort of knowing that you love them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Loving God, we pray for those living with serious illness, lonely, and for those who love them. We thank you for the emergency services who care and help those in need. We pray for our local doctor's surgery and hospital, and pray for all the staff doing their part to care and help people. We thank you for the steady progress of the COVID vaccination distribution, and thank you for the many who have received it already. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for this church, for all those people who offer their time, skills and energy for the good of your church. We thank you that we can worship you from homes through the online worship and the Bible Bites, and look forward to meeting again together in person. Lord, give us confidence to tell others about you so more people can come to know you and praise you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
So we now come to the Lord's Prayer, the prayer that Jesus taught us. And this is the visual Lord's Prayer, with pictures to aid us as we pray this wonderful prayer. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Heaven is in my heart,
and Christ is the foundation stone.
Heaven is in
And so we come to the notices. And this week, I just want to mention about the Church magazine. Now, the last couple we've had to do electronic because of the restrictions. But the good news is the April edition will be back in the paper form and be delivered. So we plan the week commencing the 29th of March, which is Holy Week, when the restrictions change, that the Church magazine for April will be delivered at some point during that week by the volunteers. Again, thank you to the volunteers. Thank you to Jackie for all that she does in editing it, for Pauline in the printing, and others who were involved in enabling this to happen. So thank you very much. There are, over the coming days, going to be more information about the Easter services. At this stage, with the gradual lifting of restrictions, the plan is to have one service on Easter Sunday, which will also be live streamed. So that's Easter Sunday, there'll be a Holy Communion service here in St. Nicholas Church. During Holy Week, there will be other services via Zoom in particular, and more details will be out through the Lighthouse in the coming couple of weeks or so. I do ask at this time, please do pray for the ministry team. There is much to consider, to reflect on, and to pray about as we come out of lockdown and look ahead and enable physical worship in church buildings. There are many things to consider. And we do just ask for your prayers at this time and the Spirit's guidance in making the right decisions at the right time. Again, thank you to Sunny, Henry and Elsie for leading us in that time of intercession. Thank you very much. Let's continue in our worship.
Song of gladness, give my praise to the fountain of delights, for in my helplessness you heard my cry, and waves of mercy poured down on my life. And where
Come towards the end of our worship this week, and now we're going to invite you to join with me and all those who'll be connecting together in worship in our fellowship as we say the words of the grace together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. God bless, keep safe, and see you soon. Bye-bye. Christ.